I'm Dr. Dilip from Bali Rameshwar's IS Academy, and today we are going to discuss a topic that is in current affairs, that is India-Nepal border dispute. So a little bit about our institution. Our institution is situated in KPHB, and we provide both online and offline coaching. And presently, offline coaching is affected by the ongoing pandemic of COVID-19. So you can avail the online coaching, which is available at 15,000 rupees. And you can download the app, that is Wali, the learning app on Play Store. And you can reach us at www.walirameshwarsiasacademy.com. And you can even contact us through this two phone numbers. And to begin about the topic proper, India-Nepal bilateral relations. First, you have to understand what are the relations that India and Nepal share. To begin with, if you see, as close neighbors, India and Nepal share unique ties of friendship and cooperation characterized by an open border and deep-rooted people-to-people contacts of kinship and culture. As you can see, these countries with which India does share border, India and Nepal border is unique as it is an open border. That indicates that the movement of people is freely allowed across the border, and there are a lot of people who have relation with people across the border. That is the meaning of kinship, and they share a common culture, very close culture. And to understand this, you can understand that the majority religion in India is Hinduism. Though India is not a Hindu state, but it is a secular state. For a long time, Nepal was the only country in the world which was a Hindu state. And now the systems have changed, and now Nepal is also a secular state. But though, because of the religions and many other things, they share a common culture. And there has been a long tradition of free movement of people across the border. And Nepal shares a border of over 1,750 kilometers with five Indian states of Sikkim, West Bengal, Bihar, Uttar Pradesh, and Uttarakhand. So this total distance, border distance between, that is the boundary between India and Nepal, is around 1,750. And Ministry of Home Affairs site, it has been given as 1,750. Whereas in Ministry of External Affairs, it has been given as 1,850. So nothing to bother about this total kilometers. And if you see this relation, whatever that is there between India and Nepal, is because of the treaty that is called as the India-Nepal Treaty of Peace and Friendship of 1950, which forms the bedrock of the special relations that exist between India and Nepal. So with this treaty, what happens is the Nepal citizens can have almost equal status, that is equal opportunities available in India as that of an Indian citizen. So you can find significant Nepalese population residing in India, that is nearly 8 million Nepalese citizens live and work in India. So if you see the map of India, you can see that Nepal is present here. And you can see the states of Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, West Bengal, and Sikkim sharing international boundary with Nepal. So here you can see much more clearly. These are the five Indian states to share boundary with Nepal. And you can see the type of relations between India and Nepal. They can be explained better by the type of various cooperations that they have between them. So one of them is about the defense cooperation between the two countries. So you know the common exercise, military exercise that happens between India and Nepal, that is exercise Surya Kiran. So that is a well-known current affairs bit, it can be asked. And apart from that, what type of cooperation is existent between the two countries? So if you see, wide-ranging cooperation in defense sector can be noted, and India has been assisting Nepal Army in its modernization by supplying equipment and providing training to those military of that country, and assistance during disasters, joint military exercises, adventure activities, and bilateral visits are some of the few things that are usually taken off between the militaries of this two country. And apart from that, you can see the well-known Gorkha regiment of the Indian Army. So it is nothing from, it is recruited from the hill districts of Nepal. So the Gorkha regiment is well known for its chivalry, bravery, and winning many wars, it is in forefront of the war. And Indian Army currently has about 32,000 Gorkha soldiers who make up to 40 battalions in the Indian Army, and they are from Nepal and they are serving in the Indian Army. So this is the type of relation that India and Nepal does have, especially in the Indian Army. And you can see, in addition to the military pension branch in Kathmandu, there are two more pension paying offices in Pokhara and Dharan of Nepal, and these officers, especially, they carry on the relation that was existent when this Gorkha regiment or the soldiers who were used in the Gorkha regiment have been working in the Indian Army. So once they are retired, their welfare is also taken up by the India. Okay, so, and speaking of the Gorkhas, Sam Manekshaw, the India's first field marshal, okay, he has said that if anyone tells you he is never afraid, he is a liar or he is a Gorkha. Means that indicates the ability or the bravery of Gorkhas. And apart from that, if you see the disaster help that India and Nepal has, in the 2015 earthquake in Nepal, what happened once that earthquake has taken place, that is about 7.8 magnitude of earthquake which has struck Nepal in 25th April 2015, India had supported Nepal through humanitarian support, and India has swiftly dispatched the NDRF teams, that is National Disaster Response Force teams, in order to aid this relief measures that have taken place in Nepal. So India always was in forefront in order to help Nepal, not only in helping them in defense sector, but also helping them in humanitarian grounds. Apart from that, the security cooperation. So being one of a friendly neighbor that India has, Nepal always had ties with India, and Nepal used to work on issues of fake Indian currency note, how to restrict the fake Indian currency notes. That is nothing but the fake notes which enter into India. So Pakistan is a major source of FICN, that is fake Indian currency notes, and because the border control is relatively stricter, and it is relatively not so stricter between India and Nepal, the rerouting of this FICN into Nepal and from there to India used to occur on a large scale. So to prevent that, Nepal had a very good of security cooperation with India in order to limit and in also apprehending the terrorists from entering into India. Then apart from that, coming to the topic original, so this is the bilateral relations in a simple sense for you to understand that India and Nepal used to share. But in the recent times, that is in beginning in 2020, the relations between these two countries have turned sore because of the border dispute. So border disputes between India and Nepal are not new, they already are existing from past, but their interest in the border dispute has been renewed in the recent days. So what is the reason for this? And the two main dispute areas between India and Nepal are notably the Kalapani dispute, and the other is Sasta dispute. So the renewed conflict relating to the Kalapani dispute is what our interest is about. So if you see the Kalapani border dispute, so where is this Kalapani situated and what is the border dispute? So the dispute over Kalapani, which lies in the easternmost corner of Uttarakhand's Pithorgarh district, that is between Nepal and India, was revived in November 2019. So if you see, this is Nepal, Nepal bordering Uttarakhand. So in Uttarakhand, the easternmost part, this area is Kalapani. So this is a disputed area between India and Nepal. And this dispute has again come into the forefront starting November 2019. That is when, after India has released a revised map of Uttarakhand, claiming the Kalapani, which is a disputed area, into a part of Uttarakhand region. So once, why this new map has been released? The new map has been released after the bifurcation or revoking the status of Jammu and Kashmir. So you know, the status of the state of Jammu and Kashmir has been revoked on August 5th 2019. So once the statehood of Jammu and Kashmir was revoked, and the state of Jammu and Kashmir was bifurcated into the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir and another, the Union Territory of Ladakh. What happened is, the government has released an updated version of the Indian map, and in this updated version of the Indian map, what has happened is, they have shown, that is, India has shown that the Kalapani, which was the disputed area between India and Nepal, has been integrated into Uttarakhand, which of the Pithorgarh district. So once this map has been published, so immediately again the dispute came into the forefront, inciting interest from both the parties. And you can see, when India published a revised political map showing the newly created union territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, both India and Nepal lay claim to Kalapani. So that is, this Kalapani is a disputed area to begin with. The map showed Kalapani as part of Pithorgarh district. Nepal protested immediately and drew attention to the lingering issue. So this lingering here in the sense means, because this issue has been present from past and is still continuing. On May 8th, India inaugurated the Dharuchula Lipu Lake Pass Link Road, cutting across the disputed Kalapani area, which is used by Indian pilgrims to Kailash Manas Sarovar. So here, what you have to understand is, this Kailash Manas Sarovar is one of a holy pilgrimage place. Assume that this is the Manas Sarovar. So this Manas Sarovar is present in the Tibetan Autonomous Region of China. So once China has occupied the entirety of Tibet, whatever that is left of the previous Tibet is called Tibetan Autonomous Region. So in this Tibetan Autonomous Region lies the holy river as per Hinduism, that is Manas Sarovar. So it is, the Manas Sarovar actually means, as per the Hindu ideology or mythology, what it means is that Brahma has thought about this lake in his mind, that is, which led to creation of this, and it is said to be the holy abode of Lord Shiva. And as per Hinduism, what it tends is, the pilgrimage to this Manas Sarovar is going to, once an individual takes a dip into the Manas Sarovar or drinks water from Manas Sarovar, it is said that all their sins of the past lives and the present lives will be totally cleansed off. So it is of vital importance in Hindu religion. So as you can see, the pilgrimage to this Manas Sarovar, okay, usually it takes, so if you see, pilgrims from India can reach the Kailash Manas Sarovar through three routes. So what are the three routes? One is via Sikkim. As you can see, Sikkim, okay, will be far off. From there, they are going to carry on. And the other is from Uttarakhand, that is the state of India. And here, from Kathmandu in Nepal, all of which are long and arduous. So from Sikkim, if at all you take the first route, that is from Sikkim. From Sikkim, they have to travel all the way into Nepal. And again from Nepal into the Tibetan Autonomous Region, that is nothing but in China, and reach the Manas Sarovar, which is a lengthy journey. And if you start from Kathmandu, again from India to any pilgrim, if you want to move, they have to move from India to Nepal and from there to the Tibetan Autonomous Region, that is nothing but in China. So majority of the part, if you see, the travel journey is present in a foreign country, that is outside of India. So there is a threat to the safety of these pilgrims. So what India has thought is that if you provide the journey time as long as possible for these pilgrims from within the country, a channel within the country, so you can take care of the pilgrims. So keeping this in mind, the government of India has planned in developing the third route, that is the route from Uttarakhand. So from Uttarakhand, if you see, as you have seen, that Kalapani has been designated as in the district of Pithorgarh in Uttarakhand. So once this Kalapani, which is considered to be within in India, from here to Lipu Lake Pass, a road has been laid. And once this road has been laid, previously the journey was very difficult. It used to take trekking on foot. Now with laying down this road, okay, till Kalapani, so previously till Kalapani only it was difficult. So once road was laid, that journey time has been reduced to 2 days on road on a light motor vehicle. And from there, They used to travel to Lipu Lake, that is the pass between India and ancient Tibet, from where the trade aspects used to take place. And from there again journeyed to the Manas Sarovar. So significantly, the traveler or the pilgrim is going to spend time more in the Indian territory only. So that is why the road, that is what you can see in the earlier ones. The Dharchula Lipu Lake Pass Link Road was inaugurated by video conferencing by our Defense Minister Rajnath Singh. And what is the benefit by doing this? See, you can see the route via Uttarakhand involves three stretches. The third stretch is 80 kilometers from Ghatiabar to Lipu Lake Pass at the China border, which can only be traversed on foot. This stretch takes almost 5 days to cover and is a tough journey. Several accidents occurred on this route. So the Border Roads Organization, that is BRO, has built a new road on the third stretch to allow vehicles. So that stretch will now facilitate the travel all the way till Lipu Lake Pass. So once they have reached the Lipu Lake Pass, which is a strategic place in, and it is also considered as a tri-junction, that is between India, Nepal and China. From here they are going to enter into the Tibetan Autonomous Region and reach the Manas Sarovar. So when India has inaugurated the route till Lipu Lake Pass, because that is going through the disputed territory of Kalapani, immediately it intrigued Nepal. So Nepal was furious that without our intimating us, India has declared a road into the disputed area. So now, what is this? Why this Kalapani is disputed? So if you see, just going, why this area is important? If you see, this road is important for strategic and tactical reasons. The Sikkim and Nepal routes are much longer, and road via Pitorgarh will ensure that most of the journey is within Indian territory. This is not the case with other two routes which required pilgrimage to enter Chinese territory. However, Nepal claims that the Lipu Lake Pass comes under its territory and lies in the Dharchula district in Sudur Paschim Pradesh and is marked by the Kalapani River, one of the headwaters of the Kali River in the Himalayas, at an altitude of 3600 to 5200 meters. And India has always considered Lipu Lake as a tri-junction with the territory to the east of the pass as the Nepalese territory. The Kali River forms the boundary between India and Nepal in this region. According to India, the headwaters of the river are not included in the boundary. So for you to understand all of this, so you can simply see that this Kalapani region, okay, the border, so how this Kalapani region is disputed is, so you have to understand something that is called as Sugauli Treaty of 1815. So this treaty was signed between the Britishers. So there was Anglo-Nepalese war which took place around 1813 to 1814 or 1816, so roughly this period. And once this war was completed with the total retreat and loss of the Nepalese, so the Nepalese side has lost, and as a retribution they had to lose significant areas to the British. And as per a treaty that was signed in an area that is called Sugauli Treaty, which was ratified in 1816, the Sugauli Treaty was signed in 1815, it was ratified in 1816, means came into force. And then once, as per this treaty, the boundaries of Nepal have been designated. That is, if you talk about the boundary between the then British India and Nepal, has been designated as the Mahakali River. Mahakali River. So this Mahakali River, it said, as per the Sugauli Treaty, the westernmost boundary of Nepal is the Mahakali River, and eastern most aspect of India, that is British India, was the Mahakali River. So if you want to settle the dispute, you have to understand the flow of Mahakali River. So as any river has tributaries and distributaries, tributaries and distributaries. So what are tributaries and distributaries? So tributaries are something which will join the main stream. So if for a river to start, water inflow is needed into the river, and that water inflow will be by different types of tributaries which are going to join the main channel of the river and lead to the creation of water flow in the river. And distributaries are, once from the main river is flowing, the river will divide into many more branches which are called as distributaries. So here this Mahakali river had different types of tributaries, and what as per the treaty is, the treaty has said that the easternmost aspect of India is limited, that is British India was limited to the Mahakali river, or in the other sense the westernmost extension of the Nepalese kingdom was nothing but the Mahakali river. So if you see the Mahakali river or the Kali river, this is the extent of the Kali river. Okay, so what Nepal claims is, so as actually the Kali river flows and it is present somewhere here, and what India claims is that only the origin of this river begins from Kalapani region, and to the east of this Kalapani region the Kali river starts. So as the Kali river starts here, as Kalapani is in the western side of this Kali river, Kalapani belongs to India. But what Nepal claims is that the Kali river is not originating here, but the origin of this Kali river is somewhere through the tributaries all the way to this Limpiyadura. So they are telling that the origin, the extension of the river is far more to the north. And so because considering all the area that is present eastward to this northward extension of the river, all this territory will fall into Nepal, thereby Kalapani also coming into the territorial aspect of Nepal. That is the actual dispute that is present between India and Nepal, and the origin of the dispute is the Sugauli Treaty of 1815, which does not clearly demarcate where this Kali river is going to begin, and whether it is going to talk about only the actual river or the tributaries of the river, and the northward extension all the way up till this Limpiyadura or not. So different cartographic evidences are presented both by Nepal and India, but there is no clear-cut evidence of what is right and what is wrong. So as tensions have flared up, Nepal, what it has done is, it has tried to gain some ground by passing a constitutional amendment, trying to legitimize all these disputed territory into a part of Nepal. So apart from this Kalapani disputed area, there is another disputed area. As you can see, there is a second dispute within India in the Sasta river border region. So what is this Sasta river border region? You can see that, assume that this is Bihar. So far above here again you have Nepal. So in this border, somewhere in this border, you have a disputed area which is called Sasta. So this Sasta is a place, as per the Treaty of Sugauli, what it says is, this Sasta is a place which is dependent on, which is described by a river which is called Gandak or Gandaki. Okay, so this river is going to decide on which side or which territory or which country does this Sasta belong to. So as per the original treaty, what it says is, the area which is present on the right bank of Gandaki will belong to Nepal. So previously what was there is, Nepal, the Sasta used to be on the right bank of Gandaki. So Sasta belonged to Nepal. But over a period of time, what happened is, the river Gandaki has changed its course, that is, changed its direction. So slowly the river has changed its course in such a way that it has come like this. So effectively, totally doing away with the direction or on which bank the Sasta river is going to be present. So once the river has changed its course like this, so bringing Sasta on the left river bank of Gandaki. So as per the treaty, if whatever landmass that is present on the left river bank of Gandaki is going to come into India. So as per an international convention that is called the Water Convention, what it talks about is whether a landmass is created by avulsion or accretion. You have two things, avulsion or accretion. So what is avulsion? Sudden removal of a piece of land means a river is flowing with high intensity, it is going to cut off certain part of the land and leading to change in the landmass. If at all, assume that because of avulsion, suddenly the river which was initially flowing like this has cut out a landmass like this, then if something change to the landmass has happened because of avulsion, it will not be considered as an actual change. So even if with avulsion this part has come like this, still Sasta would have belonged to Nepal. But coming to accretion, what is meant by accretion? Accretion is nothing but a slower deposition of landmass over a period of time. That is, slowly landmass is going to be changed by the flow of river, not in a single instant. So if a landmass has been changed because of accretion, then it will be considered as valid and that change will be accepted. So this Sasta, whatever that is because of the change of the flow of Gandaki, that it has not happened overnight. It has taken place over a period of time, and that is nothing but accretion because that is there. So Nepal has also not totally openly accepted that Sasta is a part of India, but it has not raised as much as concern when compared with that of the Kalapani. Now I hope that you have understood what the Sasta and Kalapani disputes are. So now coming to how can this dispute be settled? So you have to understand how can the dispute be settled. So you have to understand that this dispute has emerged, that is starting with the change of map, change of political map. And the second thing is inauguration of new link road for the pilgrims of Manas, Lake Manas Sarovar. So if you see this two aspects, okay, this has triggered the Nepalese government to act against India. So all these changes have culminated by the claims and counterclaims between India and Nepal during the ongoing pandemic of COVID-19. And also in the background, once India is having a dispute with Nepal, another aspect that it is having dispute is with China regarding to multiple territories in Sikkim, Ladakh. So in all these areas, there are multiple tensions between India and China. So now, will India be concerned more over India-Nepal dispute, or will it be more concerned on other urgent matters to be addressed, such as COVID-19 and India-China tensions, that is also related to long-standing disputes regarding line of actual control. So actually, because these are more pressing issues than the thing that is between India and Nepal, India has not yet responded. The government has not yet responded seriously to the allegations put forward by Nepalese government, and it is still following the wait and watch policy to see how Nepal politics are going to turn. So this, if we at all we talk, this situation has come in such a time when it has been a blessing to the Oli government. So you can see the Prime Minister of Nepal, KP Sharma Oli, he has been going through a lot of tension, disturbances within the country, within his government. And this crisis, that is the border dispute between India and Nepal, has turned out to be a blessing to his government in order to direct or change the diversion or change or create diversion in the minds of people from the internal crisis of the government to a far away issue whereby which electrifying and unifying the people so that they can all concentrate on this land border dispute between India and Nepal. So you can see that this dispute has led to a lot of tensions in Nepal especially, and Nepal government has passed an constitutional amendment including all this disputed area into their country. But India has rubbished all this, saying that there is no evidence to carry things forward. But for India, if you see India, there is no need to immediately jump and come and make it to jump and make conclusions and to take serious steps regarding this issue, because this issue has to be settled over a period of time. There have to be proper communication that will happen between India and Nepal. But what the problem is, the communication between India and Nepal is not proper. The reason being, the communication between the Prime Minister of Nepal and Prime Minister of India has not been on par as expected. So both are waiting and watching what and how things will turn out. And you can also see that in the recent times, the trust that Nepal used to have on India, or the dependence that Nepal used to have on India, is slowly decreasing. And also India has to rethink its neighbor first policy, because there are a lot of changes. So India always wanted that Nepal should be present as a buffer state between India and China. So over a period of time, what happened is, because of the change in monarchy, then the Communist Party coming into force in Nepal, India has significant doubt that Nepal would slowly drift away towards China. And India has many a times meddled in the internal affairs of Nepal. And the significant one was the 2015 crisis of Nepal, where there was constitutional change. The constitution was changed in 2015, and the significant issue was regarding the Madheshis who belong to Indian origin. And as India has a lot of interest in protecting the interests of its people, India has meddled in the internal affairs of Nepal, which it shouldn't have. And because of the land blockade during this 2015 crisis, land blockade done by India against Nepal. So even if it is done by India or not, Nepal blames India for the things that have happened. Nepal has significantly suffered because of the blockade and has decided that its dependence on India should slowly be reduced. And at a time when the world is changing and China is trying to utilize all aspects to its benefit, that is, it is trying to significantly work in ways to turn neighbors of India to its allies so that it can restrict the influence of India on those countries and on in the world itself. So in such situations, China is extending its soft loan or soft power to Nepal, and so Nepal is also happy in order to move towards China. And the fear is keep on increasing in the minds of Indians, in the sense that Nepal is drifting away much closer towards its enemy, that is China. And China is utilizing all the options that are available to lure Nepal and several other smaller countries into its hold. And as you can see, the Doklam crisis or the Doklam standoff of 2017, which was also one of the strategic points between trijunction between India, Bhutan and China, and this Lipulekh Pass is also a strategic trijunction between India, Nepal and China. And as per the statement made by the Chief of Army Staff, that Nepal is taking out or carrying out this issue on the behest of someone, indicating China itself. But you can see that the distrust that is ever increasing in the minds of Nepalese, and India also trying to intervene in some of the matters of Nepal and looking at Nepal with distrust over a period of time, the policies. And you can also see another example that Nepal has not shown interest or not attended the BIMSTEC meeting that was held, or that is nothing but carried forward by India, that is Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multisectorial Technology and Economic Cooperation. So this BMSTEC, which was put forward by India in order to limit the influence of China, not only on China, but also to lead the countries that are on the sharing the shore of Bay of Bengal. But Nepal was looking at this with speculation. So Nepal has moved out. Nepal has decided that it is going to reduce its dependence on India and thereby which taking the support of China to move forward. So India here, what India has to do is, in such a scenario, it is good that India will concentrate on more pressing issues that are present right now, that is the COVID-19 pandemic that is creating chaos in the country. And the second thing is the India-China dispute that is brewing, and it can lead and have widespread complications and implications on the country itself. And it has to address these issues first. And as you can see, Nepal is still a friendly nation to India. It cannot at the same time ignore the dispute that is running on between these two countries. If India cannot solve the issue that it has with a friendly nation, can we expect that India can easily resolve a land dispute with its enemy? So definitely the takeaway from this is that India should stop meddling in the internal affairs of its neighbors, and it should come out with an aspect that it should amicably settle the disputes with a friendly neighbor as quickly as possible, as it will threaten that if, as long as India delays the issue, there is more chance that Nepal will move much closer to China, which can never be avoided. So this is all about the Indo-Nepal dispute of the Kalapani and Sasta. I hope you have understood. If you have any doubts, you can post in the comment section. Thank you.